And we are indeed very excited that we could have a lot of interesting speakers for this afternoon. And the first speaker I want to introduce is Professor Jelte Wichertz. We are really excited that he's going to talk to us about opening up psychology data. He is a full professor of methodology in social and behavioral science at Tilburg University. And yeah, I would like to give you the floor. I'm just ending this. So yes. Thank you for being there, Jelte, and we are very much looking forward to your presentation.
Thank you, Ricarda, and thank the team also for inviting me to give this talk. I'm pretty sure that I would have said to anyone that I would be organizing or having a keynote lecture in this very tiny home office with 77 people. People would laugh at me before Corona, but I'm glad that we can go ahead, and I'm very honored to be able to talk to you a bit about data sharing, basically, in psychological science. So I'm a methodologist, I'm a psychologist by training, and I consider myself a meta researcher nowadays, because that's what we've been doing a lot in the last decade. So what I'm going to do today is going to talk about open science in psychology, but also then present to you some of the results of meta scientific findings in the last decade or so, and some older work actually, showing what the status of data sharing in psychology is nowadays. And my hope is that this will convince you that there's still a lot of room for improvement when it comes to data sharing in psychology. So this is the new integrity code that we all subscribe to as researchers working in the Netherlands. And the interesting thing is that in the new integrity code, we have an open science statement, for instance, this one, that according to one standard, we have to contribute where appropriate as researchers towards making data findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable according to the FAIR principles, and that as far as possible, we make research findings and research data public subsequent to the completion of the research. If this is, however, not possible, we establish valid reasons for non-disclosure. So open science is in the code. It is very clear that we have entered the open science era. At the same time, it's also clear, as I will show you in a bit, that we still have a lot of room to improve, because we're actually not that open yet in psychology as far as I'm concerned. And to illustrate this, I will show you two studies, one from 1910 and another from this year, appearing a couple of weeks ago. The two studies are typical psychology work. The old paper was published in the Psychological Review, well-known journal, in 1910, and both studies are about suggestibility. So this is a very interesting topic that actually, in a way, Professor Evers will also be familiar with and have much more knowledge about than I have. And the idea of the two studies is to see whether, if you measure subjects, participants' suggestibility, whether this is a single construct, single dimension, which is a typical key question in differential psychology and a key question in this field, which apparently, you know, has been a topic of interest to these researchers for over a decade. Now, what did the two studies do? The old study had two measures of suggestibility and wanted to establish the correlation. That's the 1910 study by Scott, who was actually instrumental in creating the field of marketing research. And the other study, the recent study, has actually nine different measures of suggestibility. And both studies are interested in seeing whether there's a single dimension, in other words, establishing the correlation between these two measures, or nine measures in the new paper. Now, as a methodologist, I'm interested to know whether I could reproduce or verify any of these results. And the interesting thing now is that the most recent paper, although fairly detailed, is less reproducible than the 1910 paper. This is actually a more reproducible paper for this very simple reason, that in 1910, Walter Scott published a data table, the full data table with all raw data in it, allowing me to reproduce his results, to reanalyze his old data of all those participants now long gone, I'm sure. And this is then the scatter plot of interest. It's a relatively small study, but I was able to reproduce his results. Also seeing here, by looking at raw data, that some of the measures were fairly skewed. So there's obviously in the heat suggestibility measure, a ceiling effect there leading to the skewed distribution, which, as we know, suppresses correlations. The key message here is that in 1910, and if you actually look up publications of that age, you see a lot of open data sets. These articles were very long, very detailed, with all sorts of drawings also of the methods used and the setups. So this is, you don't see an awful lot of pictures. They were not in wide use at the time. But you see a lot of open data sets. You see a lot of detail. And you actually see, intriguingly in this case as well, sometimes open reviews, because they are actually published, or post-publication review, but you can actually see the review report of this paper. So that's open science avant la lettre. Anyway, I don't think I need to convince this audience of the many, many benefits of sharing data. It enables, as I just showed you, verification or reproducibility, which is very important because it not only allows, it requires the researchers by sharing data to rigorously document what they did, but it obviously also diminishes errors and a lot of biases that we and many others are studying. It's very likely that if you do a study, that you will make some errors at some point. And it's also very likely when you do a study that your own expectations are affecting the outcomes, leading to biases. So that's where the sharing helps you to allow others to check what you did, to allow debate on what has emerged, to avoid errors, etc. Obviously, it enables the reuse of data in many different ways. I mean, the Scope data that I just showed you can be included as a raw data in any individual participant data meta-analysis even now. And this is very good because the study is very small, and a small study has low power. But if you add more studies, you can actually really rigorously and meticulously add to the empirical database. But you can also do other types of analysis with the data. New questions even that might be answered. There's quite a literature highlighting, or at least suggesting, that sharing data increases citation score. So that's good in terms of the massive interest in that, but also their effective reflection of importance in the field. It opens the door to collaboration, as I've often argued. Even if you share data, you would be still, as the researcher collecting the data, the first to be invited to collaborate because you know most about the data. It obviously changes the research culture to a more open research culture with all sorts of benefits. And finally, although I do consider this a minor problem because of the percentage of people not being honest, open data would lead fraudsters to lose sleep. They will lie awake at night much more so than they do now, because the exposure risk is, of course, higher if the data are in the public domain. But as mentioned, that's not the main thing, because it's a very low percentage, luckily, of researchers. So let me just show you a bit of the history on data sharing and psychology of the research thereon. This is a study from 1962. At that time, the field of psychology, as opposed to 1910, had increased a lot already. So what you see, there's more journals, many more people. And at that point, there became this new competition for journals places to publish. So the journals would normally start to reject more than they would accept, for instance, which also is interesting in many different ways. So in 1962, this is a study among psychologists published in the American Psychologist. Wolins wanted to check data analyses in published papers, and he sent letters, or actually his student did so, together with him, and obtained data at that time from about a quarter of the studies, but also a message that over half the data sets had already been lost. And some data sets were only shared under the condition that the original authors would be co-authors, which they did not want. So this is 62. A decade later, Craig and Rees redid that study effectively also among psychology researchers. And now, at that time, still in the 70s, the sharing rate went up to about 38%. But still, a lot of data were not available, either because they were lost, or the researchers refused to share data, or experienced trouble to sharing the data, which is also a common reason. Now, this is basically, I wasn't born in 73, but I was later when we did this study in 2005. So 15 years ago, we had actually, we wanted to reproduce analyses. We wanted to check, verify results in 141 published papers. And we followed actually the guideline of the American Psychological Association, which had published the articles that we were requesting data from. And the authors of those articles had all signed a contract that they would share data for precisely that reason, for verification purposes. And after sending some reminders, we did end up getting 27% of the data sets. Some were remarkably well documented, but others were not so much well documented, with sometimes an excusing email by the authors indicating, here are the data. I don't exactly know what the variable is, the represents the experimental condition, but if you iterate a bit with these unlabeled variables in SPSS, you might find out what is what. At the same time, we also got refusals, one of which was from a social psychologist who was working at the time in Groningen, later became the dean of Tilburg University's social faculty and became world famous for having faked his data. He did not share his data, obviously. But also just also many people just had, you know, lost track of the data. So this was also a main reason why people couldn't share them, even if they wanted to. We also had a category of researchers who were willing to share data, but had also lost track or had too little time to actually make the data fair, as we now call it. Now in 2013-14, a group of researchers from the KU Leuven, Gert Storms and Wolf van Pamel in particular, they did a replication of our study in some other psychology journals, and luckily the percentage of positive results sharing data after first or second request increased to again 38%. But that was the same level we saw in the 1970s, a time when the data sharing involved, well, cardboard boxes with a lot of data, physical data, having to go, you know, in a very slow system without the now common companies that bring things in a day. So not very promising. A lot of data not available for reanalysis. And the question is, you know, how is it now? And here's another meta-scientific study. This is the most recent thing I've seen. There might be more. It's not too hard nowadays, luckily, for several reasons, because the indexing has become better to check how often data are shared. So this is the 2020 study by Tom Hardwick and colleagues. What they did was sample 250 articles, recent articles from 2014 to 2017 in psychology, and checked whether first the article itself was available, which of course is an issue of open access, showing that at least less than half were in the public domain in some form. But of more interest to us now today is whether the data were there, but also, which is B here on the right upper hand corner, whether the materials were available. And you see that only about 10% were there any materials available. And keep in mind that I just mentioned that in the 1910s, you know, these monographs, very lengthy research articles, if you will, the materials were actually available, at least the description allow you to replicate the study. Protocols were never there. The data was only available in this study in less than 20% of the articles. So 80% of the articles in psychology, you don't see the data. It's typically not there. It's unclear whether it's there. The scripts, the analysis scripts, which do not pose any constraint with respect to privacy, typically also not with respect to intellectual property or any other copyright issue, also is typically not available. So you cannot, in that sense, reproduce the analysis by looking at what type of analysis were done. And pre-registration in this set, at least, was entirely non-existent. That is a thing that's become more popular now, but it's still fairly uncommon. So this graph, I think, quite clearly shows that psychology has not yet entered the open science era, that there's still a lot of room for improvement. So what do we blame for this? Well, first, let's blame the researchers' archiving skills. We know that the archives are there. I mean, that's why we have DANTS and many other repositories. And nowadays, many universities also give some support for this, as many of you probably know, because you're involved in this. This is how it should be, archiving, but this is typically how it is. And the photo on the right is the room of one of my mentors, who was actually very, very good in finding stuff there. I could actually say, yeah, there's a report on this from 16 years ago, and then he could grab it immediately. And sometimes he said, well, there's a report on this, but I don't know where it is, so forget about it. It's basically gone. And this is what we typically see. And this is also what Caroline Voorbroodt and some other DANTS colleagues uncovered when they, in 2010, around 2010, went to visit about 200 research psychologists or survey them in the Netherlands on their data management. And this is still an intriguing read, I think. It's in Dutch. So what you see on the right is where have you kept your data? So most of it, a third, was on the own computer. So, and then sometimes about 20% it was on a server. So at that time, slightly more than 10 years ago, some university faculties did have some functionality for storage, but it was not widely used. Instead, it was either the own computer, somewhere in the file drawer, 20%, or on DVDs or CDs, and you know, where do we put them now? Who knows? So the most intriguing part of the results of that survey by Caroline Voorbroodt, in my view, was that most of the research psychologists confused pressing save on their computer with actual archiving, which of course is an entirely different thing. So researchers lack archiving skills. There's not in this business. There are people who are, obviously, but researchers themselves don't know how to do it. This is an intriguing study where in business and economy, but if you were to do this in psychology, I don't expect much different results. And they checked and requested information that had been promised in the article. So this is a weird statement. It's looks promising that people in their articles make explicit, which is an implicit, a very clear scientific norm, namely that if you publish research, you have to share the information required to understand what has been done or to replicate it. And they indicated, these articles indicated additional information is available upon request, and these two authors then did so, and finding a response in about two-thirds of the cases, and only actual information in less than half. So that's the, you know, quite damning result, that if people promise to share something, it's more often not than it is available. And this is also what you see in other fields, so it's not psychology that is alone in this. This is a study from biology by Tim Vines that I like a lot. So what he did was send an email to three authors of a particular paper that had been published either the last year or 20 years before, and then checked whether the authors indicated that the data were still in existence. And what you see, the graph here is that the availability of the research data declines rapidly over time. So a paper that is 10 years old already drops a lot. And then if it's 15 years old, you have the mere, you know, availability by someone, typically the authors themselves, of the data already sharply declines. Now the same actually applies as a study we did a couple of years ago for the syntax of computer codes used in studies. So as we probably all know, having done some research statistical analyses ourselves, you can do the analysis in many different ways. It's important to document what you did. And what Elise Comfoots and I did in this study was to see whether people had done structural query modeling, which is a very popular method in social sciences and beyond, whether they could actually uncover and share with us their computer code or their syntax. And we got illuminating answers like, what is a syntax? So that happens sometimes. Then we had to explain what it was. But the main result is that only in a quarter or so of these cases were the code still available, allowing others to reproduce what they had done. And it's dropped rapidly over time. And this is not data here. This is simply the code they must have had at some point, but lost in the process of time. And this might also reflect simply that we get new computers and, you know, we move offices and universities, all sorts of things that on top of the mere lack of archiving skills diminish the keeping of these information, this important information. Keep in mind that nowadays it's child's play to share those syntaxes alongside the article. You can put it in repositories, you can put it in Dans, at Figshare, but most journal publishers nowadays, they allow online appendices. That's very easy to share this information and make sure it never gets lost. So who to blame? Well, maybe methodologists like myself who have taught generations of social scientists and psychologists to do the analysis, to set up studies, you know, to design experiments. If you look at the types of textbooks, this is a big pile of textbooks that that we at Tilburg receive every year from publishers who hope that we will adopt them in our university classes or education. Michel Nuiten actually and I went through all those textbooks to check how many of them actually had ethics chapters. Now, this is fairly common in the methods books, but very uncommon in statistics, as though there's no ethical aspect to statistics, which is quite a weird thing because that's where most of the debates on doing the right thing with the analysis occur. So that's uncommon, but more immediate concern is that in these methods books and in the statistics books, of all those that we checked, only in three of them did the authors of the textbook discuss data storage or data management. So whereas ethics chapters, including, you know, the ethical behavior with respect to research participants is fairly common, and data management is not in these textbooks. So it's actually a question whether education of future researchers in the field is well enough equipped to educate researchers to how to handle data. You can also blame the publishers like the API. I'm not going to go too much on this. There's a long history with me being critical of the APA, as some people might know. I'm not alone in this. So this is Gert Stoms, one of those KU Leuven researchers who tried to request data and didn't get data in 2/3 of the cases. And he actually was an editor at the editorial board of a journal at the published by the APA, who had these very strict guidelines. And then wanted to, as a reviewer, see the data of a submission he had been reviewing. And then the editor said, well, we don't do that here. And actually he got banned from the editorial board. So interesting. The APA is a bit ambivalent, I think, with respect to data. They've changed their behaviors a bit nowadays, luckily. And that's important because the APA publishes a lot of journals. And they think they have a very important, as a publisher, very important role to play. Because journal policies matter. And this is a very recent study by a group of researchers on whether a data availability statement had an effect on data availability statements, which typically in these two journals, PLOS and the BMC journals, are requiring some level of sharing of data in line with the ethics code that I began with, or a statement that the data are somehow available or could not be shared for particular reasons. And this is a very clear example in these two journals that at the moment that these journals implemented the policy that you need to, as an author, indicate where the data are, or in the case of PLOS, are required to share data if you can, that the data sharing increased almost overnight in a very, very major way. So journal policies make a big difference. They are the rule. They determine the rules in publication, if you will, so they can do an awful lot. They can also, for instance, in psychology, offer badges and promote the sharing of data. So this is what happened in the journal Psychological Science about 5 years ago, where they said, if you share your data, you get a badge. Now, the badge looks very childish, but at least in this study where they compared the sharing rates between psych science, that's a solid black line, and some control journals, the sharing rate went up as they implemented that batch policy. And many more journals nowadays incentivize the sharing of data by making it explicit by such an open data batch. There's some recent experiment at BMC that didn't immediately show such a big effect, but who knows? Maybe this helps, and if it helps, we should do it. Another interesting graph, this is work by Michelle Nijten on psychology journals, and the two journals in the behavioral decision making. This is the Journal of Behavioral Decision Making and Journal of Judgment and Decision Making, JDM, as well as PLOS, Frontiers in Psychology and Psych Science, as I just mentioned. And what you see in the graph here is an increase in sharing rate, even for judgment and decision making, to 100% after the journal said, we want you to share data or promote it. So it's quite clear that the journals have a very important role to play in promoting sharing of data. In the control journals, which is on the bottom of the graph, JBDM, Journal of Behavioral Decision Making, hardly anyone shares data, as it also applies to Frontiers, which is in a way similar to the psychology publications and PLOS that we have in the graph as well. The journal policies matter. We can also incentivize open data in other ways. That's why we, together also with some help of the former director of Dons and others in the field, launched the Journal of Open Psychology Data, which publishes, as do other journals nowadays, data papers, in this case for psychology studies. And then, you know, you get a peer-reviewed publication by simply sharing your data. So this is what we have there. It's been in existence in 7 years now. It's published by the Ubiquity Press. We're actually looking for new editors. If anyone is interested in joining that effort, please drop me a line, as they say. We can also blame ourselves, or maybe our peers. So this is a study by Bobby Lee Houtkoop and some others, published 2 years ago, where they asked the respondents, these are 600 research psychologists, whether they saw any barriers to data sharing. And the most commonly answered reason why the researchers themselves didn't share data, according to this survey, was that sharing was not common in their field, and that they would prefer to share data upon request.
We have about 5 minutes for the presentation, so it would be nice to
go
towards the end.
And I'm getting quite far. Thank you.
Yes, perfect. Thank you.
So it's not common, and I would prefer to do it upon request. Now, this is, I'm not going to go to all the results here. Sometimes the data set was too big. These are also issues. Sometimes there were obviously privacy reasons obstructing the release of the data. The slides will be shared, so if you want to look up the studies, please do. I also asked, when would you share data? And the most common reason why people would start to share data, and keep in mind, still a minority, would be that if the research funder requires them to share, or the journal, or the institution. These are over 90%. And also, if the community expects to share, as 88% of the respondents indicated that they would do so if others would also consider it normal. So you really see the social environment in which the researchers work. And it's a competitive environment as well, so that also obviously plays a role. It's actually also part of the National Survey on Research Integrity that is going to survey all researchers working in Dutch universities, including, of course, many psychologists, next month. And in the pilot survey, we actually found that the open science practices of the respondents in a pilot, that is still a fairly large survey, actually, they shared more data, they had more open materials, and published more often in open access if their peers did it too. So that's an association. But interestingly enough, in fields where open science practices were more common, the respondents themselves also considered the published results to be more trustworthy. So that's the good news. We can also consider privacy. I'm going to wrap it up here. This is a major thing and a major theme for many also attending today. And because of the introduction of GDPR, which has a fairly broad definition of personal data, we have to consider this also because of ethical concerns, but also because of the legal context. Now, the GDPR has a very broad definition of personal data, which you can argue about. The Americans have their own Privacy Act. It's more lenient in many ways, but at least it defines what we could consider personal data, which are not sufficiently anonymized, which is the key element when you share data, that the data that are shared are not identifiable, not led back to individual respondents. And this is a list of things that are in that set, including obviously names and birth dates, but also IP addresses. Now, what we did in a study that we just completed most of the data collection for, so it's a bit preliminary, is to check in 2,000 open data sets in psychology whether any of these identifiers were present in these data sets. So we looked up whether there were any IP addresses, for instance, or birth dates or names in those 2,000 open data sets. What we found was in about 5% of the data sets, we found some sort of readily identifiable bits of information, which were typically completely unnecessary for the study itself. And another 4% or so was at a heightened risk of re-identification. So the bad news is that the open data sets are not always completely anonymized. The good news is that in almost all the cases that we found, anonymizing data would have been fairly easy. And we had notified obviously the authors about this problem, and many of them actually made sure that the data identifying data were deleted, because oftentimes it's actually doable. Not always, and that's part of the some of the sessions later. So we can increase transparency, and it definitely increases accountability, and with it, trust in psychological findings. We have to do that as psychologists together, but also with many others. And journals can play a role, academic institutions can play a role, funders can definitely play a role, and of course all support staff and all policymakers can have a very major impact on improving this and making psychological science more open. This is the Meta Research Group that I want to thank alongside with the funders. This is the Meta Science Group in Tilburg, me in the back, as it should be, because they do all the hard work. I want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Jelte, for this very interesting presentation and raising a lot of issues we still have to solve together to make psychology more open. We have a little bit of time for a couple of questions. And there was already one question in the chat from Karen, who was wondering whether it's really about data getting lost or if researchers simply followed simply followed the guidelines and deleted data after 10 years from finishing
study. It's a very good question. So in the case of the data sharing studies that I presented, so these are the one by Wolens, Craig, ours, and the one in that the Leuven group did, that all these studies were very recent. So the studies had been published a year or 2 years before, in our case 1.5 years, and that's still within the either 5 or 10 year time period that you need to keep the data. It's of course still also a very important question what you do with the actual easily identifiable information, which so oftentimes is not necessary. You keep that, so that you have to also delete. And then, so there's a lot to be said about that. And also I think, I hope at least, that more attention will be addressed to this topic, because on the one hand, you have the legal framework, which is within the GDPR is very strict, because I mean, there are legal scholars who make the claim that the GDPR definition of personal data is so broad that you would even include temperature data in there. So, because you can relate it back to an individual. You know, if I say now it's raining here in Weesp, you know, you can actually use the rain data to see that I am here now, relating that back to me. So That's then personal data. So it's too broad. So my hope is that in the near future, we get more also, you know, within LCDRM, within that context, together with, you know, people working on this, we get more better best practices and better regulations as well, workable regulations, that allow us to distinguish the real personal data, if you need to have that, and all the data that you can readily re-identify. Because in my conviction is that most of the data in psychology, let's say over 85%, you don't need the personal identifiers. It's mm-hmm. not needed at all. So don't ask it. It's easy yeah. in terms of privacy, and it's you can open it up in any way you like.
So one of the questions in the chat was Karen, who specified that her question about the data that might have been deleted was about this graph that you showed where it was about data no longer available after 15 years. So she's wondering whether they maybe just deleted them and following these guidelines.
Yeah, so I don't know whether that's for what cases that was. In our data request studies, that was not an issue.
Okay. And then I'm just going to read one more question so that we can move on to our next part. But that is the question is, what is your own archiving practices, which I think maybe interesting for people to hear and maybe not easy to summarize, but...
No. So we do. So I have actually looked at my own old studies, which was quite illuminating for myself as well. So I looked at the studies in my PhD thesis, and sometimes I was not doing a very good job. I was able to relocate the data sets, but particularly the metadata was very poor. The documentation was not that easy to use. So I learn a lot from that. And so I share the data whenever I can. That's, I want to put it out of my hands, put it at DONS or any other repository as quickly as I can. At Data First NL nowadays, where Tilburg has an agreement with. For that part, for the more private part, we now work with Tilburg. And then there's all sorts of, things going on. We there was a point where we worked with Dropbox naively. And we, of course, were awakened by the GDPR and the regulations at the point. It mm-hmm. wasn't a wise thing. So we now mostly work with Surf Drive. And now there's a pilot in Tilburg also with the research drive by Surf, which is also, I think, the future. We need to have such, during the process, it's important to have the good capabilities, IT functionality, safe storage. And then afterwards, just put it in the repositories. People who know how to archive.
Yes, thank you, Jelte. I think there are still maybe some comments coming into the chat. If you want to answer those later, no. That's possible. We will now move on to the next part of our program. So thank you very much, Jelte.